Learning medicine is hard work. Osmosis makes it easy. It takes your lectures and notes to create a personalized study plan with exclusive videos, practice questions, and flashcards, and so much more. Try it free today.
Streptococcus pneumoniae, or strep pneumoniae, can be broken down into strepto, which means chain, coccus, which means round shape, and pneumoniae, which refers to the fact that it causes pneumonia. No surprises there. So, strep pneumoniae are round bacteria that tend to grow in chains, usually in lancet-looking pairs, like diplococci. They're the most common cause of community-acquired pneumonia, meaning pneumonia acquired somewhere other than the hospital. Okay, now, a little bit of microbe anatomy and physiology. Strep pneumoniae has a thick peptidoglycan cell wall, which takes in purple dye when gram-stained, so this is a gram-positive bacteria. They're non-motile and don't form spores, and also, they're facultative anaerobes, meaning they can survive in both aerobic and anaerobic environments. Finally, they're catalase negative, which means they don't produce an enzyme called catalase. Now, when cultivated on a medium called blood agar, strep pneumoniae colonies cause alpha hemolysis, also called green hemolysis, because they produce hydrogen peroxide, which partially oxidizes initially red hemoglobin in the blood agar to green methemoglobin. Other Streptococcus species, like strep viridans, are also alpha hemolytic. So, an opticin test is done to distinguish strep pneumoniae. That's where a few drops of opticin are added to the culture. Strep pneumoniae are opticin sensitive, meaning the bacteria die after adding opticin, whereas strep viridans are opticin resistant, meaning they survive. Now, strep pneumoniae has a number of virulence factors that are like assault weaponry that help it attack and destroy the host cells and evade the immune system. First, strep pneumoniae is encapsulated, meaning it's covered by a polysaccharide layer called a capsule. The capsule has pili and fimbriae, which are hair-like extensions that help it attach to the host cell. Once attached to a mucosal surface, like in the nasopharynx or the middle ear, strep pneumoniae can multiply and produce biofilms. A biofilm is basically a layer of goop-like material made of exopolysaccharides, or EPS, where strep pneumoniae bacteria live and reproduce. Comparing a biofilm to strawberry jam, the seeds would be the bacteria and the rest of the jam would be the EPS. The bacteria in the biofilm hide from the host's immune system and antibiotics, and even exchange resistance genes. Sneaky. As if that wasn't enough, strep pneumoniae also produces toxins, and the most important ones are IgA protease and pneumolysin. IgA protease destroys immunoglobulin A, or IgA, which normally binds invading bacteria, so neutrophils can destroy them. That's like a computer virus first taking over the antivirus software. And then there's pneumolysin, which activates the host's complement system, a set of plasma proteins involved in immunity. This results in a local inflammation that not only destroys the bacteria, but also the host tissues, like alveolar capillaries and pneumocytes. And here's the most interesting part. Strep pneumoniae can actually peacefully colonize the nasal cavities and sinuses, where it doesn't do any harm so long as the immune system keeps them in check, restricting their growth and preventing them from spreading somewhere else in the body. Problems come up in individuals with weaker immune systems, like infants and the elderly. Other immune-weakening conditions include HIV infection, diabetes, malignancy, or alcohol abuse. Also, some toxic compounds in cigarette smoke can weaken the local respiratory defense mechanisms, making individuals more susceptible to strep pneumoniae infections. Strep pneumoniae can cause a number of infections. One example is rhinosinusitis, which is when the mucous membrane lining the nose and the paranasal sinuses gets inflamed, resulting in fever, facial pain, and headaches. Sometimes, when the walls of the paranasal sinuses are very thin, strep pneumoniae can get into the cranial cavity, resulting in meningitis. With meningitis, people develop a fever, neck stiffness, and a headache. Strep pneumoniae can also invade the eustachian tube and cause an infection of the middle ear, or otitis media, which causes pain and an earache. Chronic otitis media can spread to the mastoid antrum behind the ear, where it causes mastoiditis. Finally, from the mastoid antrum, the infection can spread to the cranial cavity, which is another way strep pneumoniae causes meningitis. However, the most common disease caused by strep pneumoniae is pneumonia. Strep pneumoniae sticks to the alveolar cells, the pneumocytes, and releases pneumolysin, which leads to the destruction of the pneumocytes and alveolar capillaries. Pneumonia causes fevers and chills, chest pain, and cough. In severe cases, strep pneumoniae can cross the alveoli capillary wall and enter the blood, resulting in bacteremia. Eventually, bacteremia can cause serious problems, like sepsis, which can lead to hypoperfusion of vital organs. Sepsis caused by strep pneumoniae is particularly common in people with spleen problems, because the spleen plays an important role in immunity, especially against encapsulated bacteria. So strep pneumoniae infections are typically worse in individuals who have undergone a splenectomy, which is when the spleen is removed, or in those with sickle cell disease, who have functional asplenia. Once in the bloodstream, strep pneumoniae can also cause pneumococcal endocarditis, forming clumps called vegetations that damage the valves. It can also infect the pericardium, resulting in purulent pericarditis, which is where pus collects in the pericardial sac. Strep pneumoniae can also spread to a joint, resulting in septic arthritis, or it can cross the blood-brain barrier and can cause meningitis as a complication of bacteremia, rather than invading directly as a part of a primary disease. Once it crosses the blood-brain barrier, it can also cause an intracranial or spinal epidural abscess. Finally, strep pneumoniae can spread from the bloodstream to the peritoneum, causing spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. This is more common in individuals with cirrhosis who develop ascites, or too much fluid in the peritoneal cavity. Diagnosing a strep pneumoniae infection relies on cultures from biological samples like pus, sputum, cerebrospinal fluid, or peritoneal fluid. Alternatively, PCR can be done to detect strep pneumoniae DNA. Individuals at risk for a strep pneumoniae infection should get vaccinated. This includes young children below 2 years and older people above 65 years. Other high-risk groups include those with chronic diseases like diabetes, HIV, cancer, and most importantly, those with sickle cell disease and those with functional asplenia. Currently, vaccines against strep pneumoniae are divided into two main groups based on their mechanism of action. The first one is the pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine, also known as PPV23, because it contains 23 purified capsular antigens, and this one is mostly recommended in adults. Another category is the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, or PCV13, which contains the capsular polysaccharides specific to 13 strep pneumoniae serotypes, bound to a non-toxic recombinant variant of the diphtheria toxin, called CRM197, which serves as a carrier protein. PCV13 is recommended in young children. Finally, treatment for infections with strep pneumoniae require antibiotics, and the classic first line of treatment are beta-lactam antibiotics, like penicillins G and V, or cephalosporins. However, strep pneumoniae has been progressively developing resistance against penicillin and its derivatives, like amoxicillin and ampicillin. So, alternatives include fluoroquinolones, the combination of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid, third-generation cephalosporins like ceftriaxone, and cefotaxime. Ultimately, vancomycin and linezolid can be used. Alright, as a quick recap, strep pneumoniae is a gram-positive, round bacterium that lives in chains. They're non-motile, non-spore-forming, alpha-hemolytic, and opticin-positive. These bacteria are found asymptomatically colonizing the nasal cavities and sinuses, but they can take advantage of a weakened immune system, especially in very young or very old individuals, or in those with diabetes, HIV infection, cancer, splenectomy, or those with sickle cell disease. They cause diseases such as rhinosinusitis, otitis media, pneumonia, and meningitis. The treatment of infection with strep pneumoniae involves the use of penicillins, but in the case of resistant strains, fluoroquinolones, third-generation cephalosporins, and vancomycin can be used.
Thanks for watching. If you're interested in a deeper dive on this topic, take a look at osmosis.org, where we have flashcards, questions, and other awesome tools to help you learn medicine.